All right. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for EPIC's Career Series event. My name is Marguerite Huber, and I'm the Campus and Communications Outreach Manager, and I'll be hosting our event today. For those of you who are a little unfamiliar with EPIC or the Energy Policy Institute at the University of Chicago, I want to give you a quick overview of that, and then we'll jump right into our presenter today. So EPIC acts as an interdisciplinary hub for energy and environmental research across the University of Chicago. We combine the insights of economists, policy analysts, and business experts with the technical expertise of engineers and scientists. Our EPIC faculty affiliates work together to bring robust cross-cutting research to the forefront of the global energy debate, which is very hot right now. So our event today will include about 30 minutes of moderated Q&A between myself and our presenter. And then we will have a Q&A with the audience for about another 30 minutes. So some logistical notes, we will not have the chat box enabled. So if you do have a question, please use that Q&A pod. If you have any technical difficulties with that. If you do have a question for the Q&A portion, you can raise your hand during the Q&A portion and I will call on you and ask you to state your name and what school or program you're in, and then you can ask your question. We do also have closed captioning available today. If you would like to use that, you should click on the closed caption button in the bottom right. And that's about it for logistical info. So I will have Yuqi introduce herself and then we will get started with our questions. All right.
So hi everyone, I'm Yuqi Song. So I'm currently a third year Harris PhD in public policy. My interest field will be what we call triple E, environmental and energy economics. Prior to UChicago, I came from China. I went to MIT for undergraduate and graduated in 2014 with math and economics. I went to UChicago Booth for a two-year MBA program, after which I entered EPIC as a research assistant or like a pre-doctoral fellowship with the Climate Impact Lab working on climate economics. And after that, I applied for PhD programs and entered Harris and stayed there since 2018.
Awesome. Quite the resume so far. So first we're gonna dive in about your current role at your PhD program at Harris, and then we'll go a little bit more backwards and talk about some other things that you've done in the past. So first of all, just what is it that you work on in your PhD program? What are you hoping to present about with your dissertation?
I haven't totally been settled on the topic of my dissertation yet, but a program that I've been working on currently is on what's the contribution of the weather forecast system in China. So basically, as year goes by, the weather forecast quality quality improves. So as the improvement happens, how that impacts people's behaviors. So for example, if we have better information about what's going to happen tomorrow, is it going to have heavy rain, really hot temperatures, really cold temperatures? Will people have some response like decrease their labor, avoid going out, or doing some other avoidance behaviors in order to like restore their health and avoid the risk? So that's what I'm trying to study. I also have other projects on Chinese policy, for example, the road rationing policy. That's a policy aiming at pollution control. And besides Harris, I also work with one of the NRT program in UChicago. It's the data science for energy and environmental research with the geoscience department. joining many science PhDs and professors for really interesting projects related to evaluating the change of wintertime jet stream behaviors through statistical methods. And we also have some other work relating to the energy sector involvement in evaluations in China.
Very cool. So you've been in this program since 2018, you said. How much longer do you have to go?
preferably, if I want to graduate by a 5-year schedule, it will take me like a little bit more than two years to graduate, which will take me to the summer of 2023. So that's the preferable time schedule. So it's also really common that people in PhD and Harris and also Booth to take 6 years. So if that's the schedule, that will take me to 2024.
All right. So as a PhD student, what does your typical day look like? So usually during these career series events, we're talking to people who have, you know, 9-to-5 jobs. This is a little bit of a different story. So can you outline what that kind of looks like for you?
So basically, as a PhD student, I have pretty flexible schedule, at least for this year. So I'm a third year right now. So every day, so I have no major courses. So I am free to attend all the lectures I want, go to all the seminars I like. All the other times, I will just do my own research. So before the pandemic, my typical day will be on average per day, I will have like a lecture or a seminar to go to. That's usually in the noon or in the afternoon, one of which being the EPIC lunch seminar on Tuesday. And some of them is like student run, either hosted by Harris or like other students in EPIC. And there are like other workshops like BFI. So like it's approximately once per day for that, and is usually between Harris or the econ department and Booth. So like that's the three locations where you can find me most of the time. After that, so besides that, I will just like sit in my office in Harris and work on my own research. So that's like a typical day. I also have sometimes I have like TA job. And that's usually when I will like try to allocate more time, like working in a row, for example, like 3 hours, 5 hours, try to finish everything in time as soon as possible and give feedback to students. But usually that's not fixed schedule. But that's only for the third year. For the first year when I was in Harris, and for most other students who has the second year also in Harris, like we will have more coursework. So we'll go to classes. It's about 3 per quarter. So normally it's like every day we have 3 hours, 1.5 hours in class, in lectures, and every week or like every 2 weeks, we will have our problem set. So that's more like a college students, yeah.
So you said that you TA, do you TA for multiple classes, just one class, and what class is that?
It depends. So we usually give our preference to the department. They will give us feedback and try to match us with the advisors and with the courses. So I TA for the cost benefit analysis at Harris with the MPP students twice, and also once for the environmental economics classes, also with the MPP students. So I basically TA the masters. Some of my classmates in my cohort also TA classes for the PhD students. So like younger PhD students. Yeah. So the most jobs is like grading and planning for TA sessions and answering questions for the students, and keep communication with the professor. Yeah.
Very cool. So you mentioned some of your other people in your cohort. How many people are in this type of, in your program or in your year in this program?
So, when I entered, like Harris has like a special structure, like they have what they called a master program, which trained students specifically want to go to PhDs in public policy after that master. If a student entered that program, they will take class with us PhD students and then apply to PhD program. And some of them will enter Harris later on. And then they will be entering like something like they will, so for example, students will enter a year after us, but they will be a lot more like our cohort because they take class with us. So for me, like I entered a cohort with about 5 students that's actually in, actually the same as me, like doing all the class like a PhD students, but there are another 5 that's this master students who passed the class with us as master students. But after we finish the first year, they become the PhD, we become the PhD second year. So yeah. And we spend like a series of different areas, many of them in education, labor, development, urban economics. So doing really interesting research.
Cool. And now that you're out of the first 2 years or you're doing a lot more coursework, how often do you ever see, well, doesn't really count now because you're not really seeing anyone, but how often do you see or work with the other members of your cohorts?
We have our cohort organized like a workshop, a student workshop every week, and everyone has to present their work like once in a while. So actually we see each other every week, and we have Slack channel, WhatsApp, and everything to discuss. But like it's during the pandemic, but I think they have this idea before that, try to get people connected and help with each other, because like Harris or like UChicago in general are more like losing structure, and students will likely to just form a group and try to help with one another. Otherwise, if you just try to contact the advisor, sometimes it's not enough. Discussions. That's what our feelings are.
Very cool. So can you talk a little bit about how you ended up in this program and what led you to wanting to get your PhD and why the jump to Harris from Booth?
I have been wanting to do a PhD since very early in undergrad. I did RA with economics professors in MIT, like back in 2010, whatever, something like that. It's like really early, not 2010, 2012. Yeah, really early stage. But I haven't thought through like what sort of like sub areas or field, what we talk about as field of the PhDs that I want to take. As like a graduate after the undergraduate program, I just do like application to both the finance and economic programs in general. Basically they do not really require you to have too much background. And I got into Booth, so I decided, I think finance is interesting, so I came to Booth. After 2 years, however, it turns out that I lack the background knowledge in financial markets, and it gave me like less incentive and less motivations to do like really good research in finance. So they advised me to leave the program and with an MBA. But then I just think through like with the half year in the MBA program, like whether do I want to go to the industry with the MBA degree, go to like financial jobs like all the other MBA students, or do I still want to do like an academia career? And I think the answer is I still want to do like the academia job. So I contact Professor Greenstone, who was my undergrad thesis advisor in MIT. He advised me to take a job with Epic. And that's when I went to Epic. And I joined the environmental and energy economics groups. And I figured out that's a really interesting field. And I have more ideas flowing up about like what I need to research, what I want to write about. So afterwards, I just applied to economics and public policy schools and entered Harris to continue all the works that I have done.
Cool. So last question on the PhD program. What do you like best about it? And what have you found to be the most challenging?
I think the best thing about the PhD program is like you are really flexible with, I think, basically a lot of things. One of the example being like a schedule every day. You can plan your own schedule. And if you skip one day or two, basically little people know about it even before the pandemic. Well, nobody is taking check on you. Another thing is like you have really a lot of time to think through a lot of like questions. For example, if you have a research project, you are free to like thinking like all day long, doing all the research, knowing really, really well about it, and getting really context about what's the frontier research on everything. Being in a university and talking to all the researchers that's coming in to do their lectures and introduce their own research. So that's good. Shortcoming side, maybe like, I think it's like a sunk cost entering into a program of 5 years. So eventually a university is more like a bubble inside a society. So if eventually I want to go out in industry, I'm guessing like I will need more preparations to do like all the other things that some of my classmates in undergrads or in MBAs already have encountered going into the industry job. Yeah.
All right. So a little bit about Booth then, since you've got multiple experiences here at UChicago. Were you involved in anything at Booth or inside or outside of Booth that added to your skill set in energy and economics, or did you mostly just focus on your schoolwork?
So at Booth, I mostly focus on my schoolwork. So I stayed here for 2 years, and the structure of Booth is the first year do the basic economics courses with the economic department, and second year do the finance course. So I have two straight years of courses. So so it's like 9 courses each year. So it's actually really packed, but it's really good training. I got I learned all these courses in economics and finances, and they just look really good when you print out your transcript. And it's actually laying out really good foundations because like many of them is like required. Though I'm no longer in finance, it helped me a lot in like looking through the lens of macroeconomics of many of the problems, because even though if you are doing something like microeconomics, you have to relate back to like a higher level of social impacts and stuff like that. And knowing about the financial markets is actually really helpful.
Great. Sounds like it set a really great foundation for you. So a little bit more on extra things you've been involved in. You are a DRW fellow currently with EPIC. That is a graduate or PhD level fellowship available. Can you talk a little bit more about what you're doing in that role and what you've learned so far?
I think the fellowship allows me to do my own research with some of their fundings. And I haven't used too much of the funding yet, but I try to explore my own research areas under the DRW framework. And the So I think one thing I did that's really important I think it's really interesting for me is in the summer of 2019, when it was first year in Harris, the EPIC just found its EPIC China branch and applied for a RA-ship or like more like a research field work experience with EPIC China. And I got assigned to Beijing for 2 months. So professors hooked me to the CDC in China, and I got to talk to some of the Chinese professors where I can get contact to locally. So EPIC found me on that experience. I think it's pretty interesting. Though if I did not have, like immediately did not get a research project out of that, I did help with some of their local researchers. And I got some contacts and knowing about the local data sets, and yeah, that helped me with my own research because later on, most of my research focused on data sets in China.
Awesome. And then you also worked with the Climate Impact Lab. So can you talk a little bit more about your experience there?
In the Climate Impact Lab, so I entered as a research assistant for the what we call the energy sector. The Climate Impact Lab is basically studying about what's the climate's impacts on different, what we call sectors on different human behaviors. For example, there are labor, there are mortality, and I work for energy. So basically like what energy consumption what energy consumption changes with the change in climate. So it's like evaluating the response of temperature of energy consumption with temperature with historical climate, and then project to the future. So it's actually pretty interesting, and that really helped laying out the empirical framework of my own research, because I'm using like a really similar design of the weather focused project I've been working on.
Great. And then were there any other internships or opportunities that you took on either during undergrad or graduate school? Anything else?
Most of the so it's not really internship. So all of my like so when I was undergrad or when I have coursework, all of these like holidays periods will be given to like RA ship. So it's like the EPIC China experience. I will have an RA in the summer with a professor when I was in MIT with a professor in labor, and later a professor in econometrics. Also the other experience, like I received like a funding, I write a paper. So everything is like more like a research assistant job and stuff like that. But I think it's really good because it lay out the foundations for me. I need to know how to code. I need to know how economists do their research, participate in all their discussions, and just build up your own, build up my own interest and determinations to like do a PhD afterwards.
Yeah. So then moving on to what you are looking at in the future, what do you envision as your next step after you do finish your program?
So as most classmates in my cohort, my first choice will be trying to get an academic job, either like a postdoc or actually finally trying to be ending up in a university. Doing a research job and try to work on the tenure paths to be like a professor eventually. That's, I think most of the PhDs have that goal. But I'm also looking into the other jobs like industry jobs, go to consultant firms and work for a nonprofit. So like that's all the alternatives as well.
What would be your dream job then?
The dream job will be having a good offer from a university and become like a professional researchers, and actually be still in this area, like Triple E.
Cool. And then as this quarter is coming to a close, some students might be thinking about their futures and what they're going to be doing next. Do you have any advice for students who are starting to think about the next step after graduation?
I would say, like, if anyone is considering doing like a PhD in environmental and energy economics or anything related, it will be a really good time to do so, because probably after 5 years, the job opportunities will be good. That's what I would expect. And also, I really like this field. It's really interesting, and there's a lot to explore, and you will learn a lot. It's interdisciplinary, and many people from both science and social science entered the ground and got to talk and learn about a lot of stuff. But if you do want to do a PhD, also think it through, because it's like 5 years. And it's a lot of like commitment. Even though if you have all the flexibility, the clock is always ticking on when you will be graduating, when you'll be wanting to have like a professorship, and what's the deadline if I want to submit anything. Yeah.
Definitely. Okay, that kind of wraps up our little Q&A session. So for attendees, if you have any questions, please do raise your hand, and then I will call on you and ask you to unmute yourself so that you can talk. Say your name and your year or program, and then you can ask your question. So the floor is open, and until you guys ask any questions, I will continue asking some more questions and we'll just keep chatting. And then we'll get to your questions when you guys are ready. I'll give you a few seconds. Okay. So while you guys are thinking of questions, I'm going to bring it back to the PhD program. We could talk a little bit more about that. Do you have a mentor or advisor that you work with on a daily or any amount of time? And how have they helped you, if you have one?
I do not have like a advisor that I work with daily. What is working Harris is when students coming in, we are being assigned like a faculty advisor by the department. That's for the first 2 years. And from the third year, we can ask for our own advisor when we know which field we are in. But normally we will talk to the faculty members we like, and if we have a project, we may talk to them more often, like communicating, rotating like through and through about ideas, like what's the updates and everything like that. And I'm more in that field. So I'm in regular contact with Professor Ryan Kellogg. He is my main advisor on the current projects I have, and he gives me all the advice on any new ideas I have. We meet about like once per month. I also talk to the other professors in the EE fields, like Professor Gina and Professor Frank and Professor Ito. So like it's actually pretty free, like a lot of people you can talk with, but it's not really like assigned, or like there's not like in book or in paper, in text, like this is my advisor. After I think before we do our thesis proposal, we will have to say who is in our committees, and that will be like more like a formal advisor type. So that's me, but my classmates have other paths. They may have like a joint work with a professor. They may have RAship with professors. So that will give them like more contacts with the professors they want to work as. And also students from the master programs, before the Harris will likely also have a professor that they work with during their mastership, and that continues into the PhD.
Great. Sounds like you have a lot of access to people, whether or not they're like an official advisor. So that's great. So since starting your PhD program, what kind of new skills have you developed as a professional since starting? I know you had mentioned coding. Is there any other things that you can add to your resume from this?
I think the most important thing I learned during the program is more like presentation. So the Harris program and the coursework that is designed has some focus on the presentation skills. And we are required to present at least once a year in a PhD workshop. So more like a regular checking with everyone in the department, what are you doing? And also, like I said, the students in my cohort do our own workshop. So it's like regular communications, like repetitive, like presentations, repetitive, like discussions about the research we have been doing. So it's actually really helpful because eventually, no matter what we do, we will have to present that to someone, either the general audience or someone in our field. And that's crucial to our path entering like academic job.
All right, we do have a audience question, so I'm going to allow them to talk.
Hello.
There you go.
Hi, this is Xingyi. Thank you for sharing. I'm actually a Harris Master alum in 2019, and I'm now also working on energy-related research. And I'm also thinking about applying for PhD probably next year. So I'm gonna ask like, maybe about the admission to PhD programs. What do you think are things you are admitted to business school and also economics and policy schools? So I'm wondering, what do you think are the most important things that the admission committees are looking at when they are thinking about the offering the PhD positions? And also, are there any other PhD programs in addition to the Harris PhD program that you applied for in the field of energy and environmental economics? Thank you.
It's a great question. All right.
Okay, so first of all, I have to say like the admission criteria or like preference have been changing quite a lot during the past 5 years or something. So I had two rounds of PhD applications. First, right after my graduation from undergrads, that's 2014, and the second in 2018. So I'm at really, really different stage in that two round of application. So the first round in 2014, I'm like a really fresh, like really young, in a sense, really young in age as a PhD applicant. So what I have is a good undergrad institution, and I have degree in mathematics and economics, and they really like people with math background. I have some research experience. I have research assistant jobs in MIT, and the professors I work with are really kind and give me really good recommendation letters. So the first round of PhD applications, I think, and actually one of the school that give me an offer say that explicitly, we like you because you are young, you are like active, you do not look like non-motivated. We think you have great potentials and you have this good grade and you look really enthusiastic in the field. So that's what they told me. Actually, when I do that round of application, the shortcoming will be really clear that I actually do not know too much about the field I want to work with, and I also do not know too much about what will be a researcher's economics like. So that's actually like a big shortcoming I didn't realize then, but they took me in, many school give me offers. I think it's probably because like I'm young, I have potentials, and I have good grades, and my reference letters are good. The second round is in 2018, that's 4 years later. And it's actually harder then because I have experience at Booth, and that's more like a shortcoming in my application. But the good side is I have more experience, especially in EPIC, and I'm applying specifically to the field of EEE. So I know a lot about what's the potential project I want to work at. I have like a direction envisioned, and I know all the methods I've been all the methods I need to work. And I'm clear about in each of the institution, what is the professors I want to work with and what's their research. And basically during the years you're working as a research assistant, like, you know, like how to look at all the literatures, look at how their introductory pages, and just recognize, okay, this person is working at something that's similar to mine. So like that goes much more smoothly. So I think for the second round, the important thing is that I have research experience, and EPIC gave me like a really good platform, also like really good reference, because my professors like so my reference letters writers this round is more like focusing on my research job. I think in your case, it will be more important to note that the admissions will be likely to try to want to know like your research experience and what do you know about your job and what do you want to work at later on. I think they are discussing like saying people now entering the PhD program is being more and more focused. So many of the people, so in 2014 when I entered, they said it's perfectly okay, you have no idea of what field you want to work at. And it's even perfectly okay that I enter a finance program without knowing too much about finance. So that's okay. But like as time goes by, they may want people that's more specified. They want people to know, okay, I want to work at, for example, the asset pricing, the financial risk of new energy firms. That's what my direction I want to work at. And they want someone who, when they entered, even though you have like a first or second year of courses, you can directly already go into your proposed projects, and you already have sub faculty members you want to talk with. And so like, even when you are doing your coursework, you already start your research, and that will like shorten the time frame when you reach your graduation, and also give people more impression like this person know that he or she is going in the academia path. So that's what I think like they are looking at. I may be, that's, 2018 is again 3 years ago. It may also change. So I hope it's helpful.
Yeah, thank you.
I'm on mute. Do you have any additional follow-up questions?
No, I think I'm good. That's a really informative to me actually. Because I just started to looking at schools and trying to, as you said, like figuring out what specific field that I should focus on. And
I remember you have another question about what programs is focusing on EE, right?
Yeah.
So there are a couple of public policy schools like Harris, and I think the one in Michigan. We have like a formal EPIC fellows going there. And one of the top one and hot one is Berkeley Agriculture and Research ARE. Yeah, that's like one of the top one. And of course you have the Harvard Kennedy. And another one is Cornell Applied Economics. They have the structure in Cornell is a little bit more complicated, but I think the applied one is, it has like good professors in Triple E.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Okay. Thank you.
No problem.
All right. Thank you. Okay. I don't see any more raised hands at this point. So I think we're going to wrap up just a little bit early. But I do want to say thank you again, Yuqi, for joining us. This was really great and informative to learn a little bit about a different career path than we've talked about in the last few sessions. So we do have one last career event coming up on May 13th. That'll be our last one for the academic year, and that's featuring Andrew Bray of MXV Ventures. So that's May 13th at, I believe it's at 12. You can register on EPIC's website. And yeah, so that's it for today. Thank you everyone for joining us, and thank you, Yuqi. And we'll see you all later.
Thank you so much for inviting me.
Bye.
Bye.